Okay, you're on record, right?
Yes, that's what the pose means.
We've been ribbing her for just taking pictures
of all the girls.
Yeah.
All right, so this is for you, Mom.
Yes, Mom, we love you.
Anyway, I just want to thank everybody for coming. It's really sweet that we can be here. I haven't been to this gravesite in 50 years, 49 years. So I really appreciate being here and having been there with Dad on the day just before he died, and you, I guess, were there on the day right after he died. So it was a challenge, but it's been a year. Dad would have been 95 years old day before yesterday. It is just amazing, his years. So anyway, the purpose that we're here is both to honor our father, the father of your father, our father's father, for whom all, you know, by which all of this is possible, and most of all to honor our Heavenly Father, to comfort one another, to remind one another of the goodness of why we're here, and the goodness of what we're saying goodbye to. So if we can begin, I'm going to call us to worship. If you look on page one, wherever you see bold type, everybody just read that. I'll read wherever it's not bold type, unless it's like Psalm 23, where I ask you to read, or John, or the poem in the middle, where I ask you to read. So anyway, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And in the paper bag back there is my child.
I'm going to read. God of all grace, we give you thanks because of his death, our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death. By his resurrection, opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Alleluia. So if we can sing together, I'll just chime in and you can follow. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free, while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Alleluia. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. His truth is marching on.
I am the resurrection. Life, saith the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not as a stranger. We brought nothing into this world. It is certain we can carry nothing in, nothing out. The Lord gave, the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen.
The reading of the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. Righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Together, if we can pray, Father of mercies, and God of all comfort, grant us grace this day to count our own days with wisdom and understanding, that we may stand confidently before our Lord with joy and assurance on the last day. We can sing.
Be still, my soul, Lord, is on thy side. There patiently cross of grief or pain, leave to thy God to order and provide. In every change he faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, thy best, thy heavenly friend. Through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past. All save and bless leads to a joy at last.
Amen. Amen. Well, the songs are included and the words are included, the prayers are included for our comfort. We come to a time that's a challenge for all of us, but it's a time that all of us will face at some time in the future. And it's by God's grace that we have not faced it yet. But we come here because we've lost one who's dear to us. Our Father stood rather large in his presence, and we all have our own particular remembrances. There's something I'd like to read. I had a chance to collect my thoughts on, but Diana, Priscilla, Brad, any of you, Claire, or Elijah, any of you, Amelia, that you remember about Grandpa or Dad, you'd like to share? Be a blessing.
Not yet.
Okay.
Give me a few minutes.
Thanks.
I'm just very grateful that I was able to make the spoke to him. Thank you to technology and FaceTime.
Yeah, yeah, thank God for that.
And
you got to FaceTime with,
yep,
with Dad. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
I FaceTime with Mom.
Yeah. Did Dad follow the FaceTime at all?
A little bit. Well, towards the end, you know, he was just getting very confused.
Yeah, sure. Right. But we got him in once
again. But we, you know,
technology is really strong.
He kept his you know, feelings tight to his chest.
That's true.
So we didn't really talk much.
Matter of fact, last time we were there, Dad muttered only one straw. The time he was there, he pretty much lost his ability to speak. And he finally said one word, and that was no. And when I had asked him repeatedly, do you feel okay? Do you feel okay? Are you in pain? Are you comfortable? That's all he said the whole time we were there. But the very last thing he did, just before we left, Elijah and I sang for him and prayed for him the last day we were there. And he smiled. First time he smiled the whole time
he
was there.
He loved music.
Yeah. So, I mean,
and
we all...
And Mom sang to him, too.
Mom used to go in there and sing regularly.
No, but when I went there Thursday morning and told Mom Daddy was sick, she went there that afternoon like she normally would. And she recited the Lord's Prayer and sang to him, I love you truly. And he passed 3 hours later.
Wow.
And I think that was just like, my God, that was so touching. Yeah. And the last thing that he remembered.
Right. Yeah, well, that's enough of that. That's a great thing to
do. Dad was, as he said, a man of few words, kept his feelings inside. Very stubborn, hard to get anything out of him. Dad and I were back a lot, but I knew deep down how much he cared for me, how much he loved me. Those piercing blue eyes just told the story just in itself.
Yeah, like this.
Yeah.
You know, like that color.
Those blue eyes just kind of, you knew where you were with him.
Yeah.
He just looked at you with those eyes and gave you that nice little smile. And I felt that what I've done and helped them over the last 30 years, I feel proud of what I did for them, and I think
Dad
felt
blessed
that way, but he wouldn't say it. And
Dad,
I
hope
he said it to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, he said it to Tom.
He said it to me.
Yeah.
And that's okay.
Yeah, that is a fantastic.
So I'm so glad I was able to take care of him during those years.
He always looked out for you. Tell him what he told you the day we got married.
Uh-oh. Be careful, love Chuck. You throw things away. Uh-oh.
Oh, man. Whoa. He throw things away, and then here's a funny story. We had these beautiful champagne things in a box.
It wasn't on purpose.
Dad did.
I thought they were trash. I didn't. I was straightening up, right?
Oh, so that explains it. This is why you keep everything
to make up for what you lost.
And Dad got it.
And I'm the opposite.
For so well, no, I
throw
that. Get rid of it.
Just can't.
Yep.
No clutter.
No clutter.
I'm a weird in between. Live in very tiny.
Yeah, Dad was able to keep everything.
She's a keeper, I'm a thrower outer.
We used to wander through the mazes of books that were up to the ceiling.
Yeah.
Oh, what about that pile of clothing where you could just, or material where you could just pick up the material and come immediately?
Dad was, the one good thing about moving Mom and Dad out to California was they really relished in their grandkids. They loved being with grandkids. You know, I think they took them out for portraits and stuff like that a couple times.
Yeah.
But they, you would drive to kids.
We have that portrait with Claire.
And they just love playing grandparents. They really did. Probably.
Dad Dad was a Midwesterner. I feel like Dad might have kept his feelings to himself.
No, Dick was like, yeah,
you got to be a Midwesterner.
But anyway, I wish I had more time.
No, I was going to say, that holds true for me too. He's a very strong presence.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But the most time you spent with him, you were this big.
Yeah, yeah, so that might be part of it.
Black licorice, jelly beans, and looking at the TV in the corner.
And the same with you. You spent your first 5 years at Grandpa's house on a regular basis.
Yeah.
Amelia, you would have gotten to go out a couple times a year when you were little. What was the first time you were?
Well, they came out. When you guys came out for Christmas a couple times, we all
just let them talk to you.
No, it's just all eventually.
Okay, no, go ahead.
What I was gonna say is, you know, the few memories that we have of whatever they may be, it doesn't matter whether they are few or many, because the ones that you do have are what some of them have. So as long as someone remembers you, then you still live on. And I think it's a nice thing to remember as more, but also celebrate
the fact that,
as long as we remember
him, he's still alive. I was extremely fortunate to have a somewhat lively conversation about him, and we talked about Polly Prep and
Brooklyn. Oh, wow.
And he smiled for me a bunch of times, and I, you know, that was the only thing I can really remember, but from what you guys have all had, like, I feel very fortunate that I had that
memory. And you have that Polaroid that we took of Dad.
Yeah, I have a beautiful picture of
him. Yeah. Part of our being here is just the assurance that it provides us of the enduring nature of what God has given us in family, because every one of us, except for Brad, except by law, carries something, and Nita too, carries something with them from Grandpa, and from great Grandpa. Everybody, I'm saying everybody here, except for our spouses, all carry something in their genes, their temperament, things that you may not even be aware of. If you were to run into your great grandfather by some miraculous cause, you would notice just what, you know, how he does this, or, you know, something. You go, wow, I do that too, or my,
crazy,
or my sister.
Everything.
it's amazing.
Crazy how genetic everything is.
It's amazing. Yeah. But this plot memorializes, the purpose of memorializing is to provide a permanence for memory, that we remember what has come before us, that we didn't make ourselves. We stand on the accomplishments of those who came before us. They gave us our genes if they gave us nothing else. But they brought us into the world, and if our parents did anything for us, if they never did anything else, they gave us life. And Dad was a blessing in that he gave us that. I'm very aware that we have different experiences. If Mike were here, he would have so many things to say that even I wouldn't recall. And I can think of so many things that you may barely recall, and you probably won't recall at all, because we're all separated by 3 or more years. And so, because of the challenges that we endured growing up, what Dwight and I recalled is markedly different, and by the time things got probably the most difficult, you already had a degree of independence. So I'm very aware of what a burden you guys bore because of those circumstances, but if nothing else, we're aware that they're over. Dad no longer bears that. We no longer bear that in the household anymore. But Dad endured through all of that in order to keep us as a family, at a time where I can guarantee you every one of his brothers would have said, leave LA.
Yeah.
Every one of his lawyer brothers would have said, leave LA. And God only knows what that would have done for us. So Dad was dedicated in that regard. I wrote a few thoughts. I brought it with me, and we can listen to it at the restaurant. I brought Dad's tapes from when he drove across the country in, what was it, 1991?
Oh, 91.
1991.
Wow. He did tapes.
And when you listen, when you hear him talk, you go.
He did tapes when he was driving. When he went to California and stayed at the motel.
I didn't know that.
He recorded everything, and he just journaled it. And I'm listening to it, and everything about the inflection, the things that come to his mind, is like, oh my gosh, look at that. So I'm listening to him talk, and a bunch of thoughts came to mind. So I'd like to just read for you, if I could. We've all commented to some degree about Dad smiling, getting him to smile. When Dad smiled, it was really magical. I think Dad didn't express his feelings, but Dad would smile at me. And I don't recall, unless he was peeved at me for some stupid thing that I did. And 99 times out of 100, I was guilty, or Dwight was guilty.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember it, you were too young, but you probably remember, we were going to get to go to Freedom Land. Freedom Land was, where was Freedom Land? On the Hudson River. You're not from New York, so. Yeah, it was an amusement park.
I didn't know that.
It was an amusement park, like a miniature Coney Island. We were going to get to go to Freedom Land. We had been thinking about it our whole lives. We were living in Northport, and we were going to get to go, and Dad didn't take us on trips very often. He was tight with a nickel. And we were all ready to go, but Dwight went outside in the backyard with the golf balls.
Uh-oh.
Dad told him to be careful with the golf balls. He drove a golf ball to the storm window in the kitchen.
Oh,
Dad saw it, and we're not going to Freedom.
Thank you, Dwight. I appreciate that. Like, really.
So anyway, that's one of the times when Dad did not smile on us. But Dad did smile so often, and that's kind of the way he said, you are special to me. You matter to me. You're important to me. You mean the world to me. And I know that Dad was very disappointed in so many of the ways he was not able to provide what was provided for him. He was very aware of it. But I know people grown up in very privileged situations who have no concept of the sufferings of others and the difficulties. And you know, you don't know why God does what he does, whatever his grace he provides. Our lot gives us things that we don't even know about. It makes us mindful, makes us artistic. It's thoughtful in ways that otherwise we wouldn't have been if it weren't for the challenges we go through. So I wrote that Dad could make you smile, and you were happy to see it. I remember how easy he was to chuckle while he spoke, sort of laughing to himself about a memory or a joke while he told it. Dad was lighthearted, he was bright-eyed, and bushy-tailed, as he used to say. He was sentimental and emotional, as almost no one needs to be told. But Dad understood when people went through hard times, because he knew what hard times were. It saddened him as children went through difficulties that he never wanted for them, and did not have many of the advantages that he had. He wanted the best for his wife and family, and he did his best. He was devoted and faithful to his duty. He was a responsible employee, and well thought of. So much of what characterized Dad reflected Christ, because he did not advantage himself. Not burden others for his own benefit. Like Christ, he set himself aside for those he loved. We knew he loved us, although he never said so. He didn't have to. Just the way he related to us. Even complaining and nagging, we knew it was because we mattered to him and wanted the best for us. It may have seemed like he favored his boys, fathers often do. But you know, it was only the girls that he gave affectionate nicknames to. Dee Dee Lou, and Pixie. Dad is the one who called me Pixie. To Dwight and I, it was more often, you're a beaut, you are, or you'd make a better door than you would a window. Dad didn't have affectionate names for us. He had admonitions for us. I have read through a number of the cards and letters that Dad kept. And yes, Dad did keep everything. I spent years stealthily throwing so many of his things away. But these things that he kept because they were special. He kept all the cards and letters we ever sent him. And reading through many of Dwight's, boy, I miss Dwight, and I wish that he could be here. But Dwight went out of his way to tell Dad how much he loved him. I brought some of Dwight's cards. You know, Dwight really just went out of his way to tell Dad, I love you, Dad, you mean all the world to me. And Dad had a relationship with Dwight. Dwight had a relationship with Dad that I didn't understand, that I didn't know. But I had a piece of it, and you had a littler piece. You know, we all had a littler piece, but you know, Dwight's the firstborn, so. Anyway, he went out of his way to tell Dad how much he loved and appreciated him. Dwight and I saw a part of Dad, and Mom as well, that could best be described as almost normal. birthday parties, going to church, family get-togethers, times over at Grandma's house. Chinese food, I remember, on Sunday nights when Uncle Aki would drop by, and he always, without calling in advance, which always bugged Dad to no end because Dad was raised to do things properly. And he'd come with a quart of vanilla ice cream, always vanilla ice cream, and he would slip a $5 bill into my and Dwight's pocket.
Sweet.
We liked when Uncle Aki came to visit.
It was a bribe.
Dad whistled. Dad sang. Dad would weep. And he shouted. There was no pretense in Charles K. Gravenhorst. What you saw was what you got. But he could talk to anyone, and no doubt the skills served him well in advertising and getting Mom to marry him. But Dad could talk to anyone, just start gabbing with a total stranger like they were old chums. It amazed me. And yet, he could be so shy and insecure and defensive. Something about being the youngest son, I guess. But Dad made you want to be with him. I loved to sit in the family room and watch TV and just hear him comment on, well, everything. Dad had plenty to say. Not just to say something, but something to say. When he went out, he would say, I'm going out to do errands. Want to come? And I almost always did. We'd tool around in the car. He would smoke White Owls. He'd have the radio on. He would talk. I would talk. We'd have fun. Dad liked fun. Matter of fact, he writes about that in his letters. It seems that the one thing that he sought everywhere today was to have fun. But too often, life did not provide Dad with fun. It provided hard work, like college and a job. It provided duties, like war and a family, often interchangeably. And hardships. But Dad bore it all. And I wouldn't ever say that he did so uncomplainingly, because that would not be true. But Dad's complaining was generally just noise. Just squawking. Insecure squawking. It wasn't serious. Because he still did what he had to do. He didn't abandon us. He didn't abandon his responsibilities. He didn't abandon his job. He did his best. And through his challenges, I know that I, at least, grew to understand many things I never would have understood with any other father. I learned to appreciate what we have. Lita is performing in a play, Our Town, by Thornton Wilder. I don't know if you've seen the play, but one of the themes is that the girl dies in childbirth, and she comes back to be able to celebrate again her 12th birthday, which, wow, she thinks is the happiest day of her life. And she's there like a ghost, and she's trying to get everyone to just notice her, and everyone's running around. Now, of course, this is New England. It's, yeah, even worse than New York. They're running around. They're all busy doing their thing. Got to do their thing. And she's saying, please, just look at me. Take time. Just look at me and appreciate what we have. We don't appreciate it. We're too busy running around. Well, that often is the case. Sometimes we don't appreciate things. We just no time to grasp them. But Dad taught me to appreciate things, and there are so many things, so many people to appreciate. And it sometimes seems overwhelming, and it seems that all we do in that regard is fall short. And Dad knew that he did not achieve the dreams that he set out to achieve. One of his favorite songs, oddly, was from The Man of La Mancha, The Impossible Dream. It was not only a theme song for the 1969 Mets, but it related a hope that was native to Dad's personality. He was optimistic. He had to be. He could not have survived in the circumstances without it. And it rubbed off, at least on me. Dad knew so much. He loved history, majored in history. He could tell you like anything about anything. American history, European history. I mean, he knew things like the Treaty of Tripoli. I didn't heard of it. He'd memorized things like the second inaugural address of Abraham Lincoln, whom he admired. In fact, one of the first times I ever, matter of fact, one of the only times I ever heard Dad quote scripture is when we were watching a program on TV about Lincoln, and they were reciting part of the second inaugural address, and I got to the end, and Dad recited it along verbatim until we got to the last part, wow, which is, and a house divided against itself shall not stand. And I remember how emphatically he said that, because he'd gotten, Dad knew that by heart. So there were a lot of things I got from Dad. I was blessed that I was able to do well in school, but you know, Dad was the number one IQ when they took the test in his entire regiment, which I think is 3,000 people. I forget how many people are in a regiment. He had the highest IQ in his entire regiment, 407th. Dad graduated as the number one general knowledge scholar in poly prep.
Oh my God.
The quote for his yearbook was, his years doth not warrant the greatness of his knowledge. Basically, he was smart beyond his years.
Wow.
And he graduated with honors from Princeton. Dad was brilliant. But we get little pieces of Dad. Some are good, some are not so good. Some we can be blessed by, and some we have to live down. But they came from someone before us. God has given us everything. That's what we're here to remember, be grateful for. Lita had pointed something out to me with Dad, that in terms of Dad's ability to look at things, Dad really did reflect so many of the things that God gives us in his own character. Just simply the fact that all things come from him, and that he gives those to us. He does it without any hesitation and dedication. And yet we're mortal flesh. We have all our shortcomings. And Dad certainly had his shortcomings. We don't idolize Dad as some perfect father that we can never, you know, rise up to. And yet we love Dad, because we knew Dad loved us. Dad was confirmed in 1938 at St. Luke's German Evangelical Church, which is just down the road here. It stopped being a congregation 3 years ago.
Oh,
and this wonderful building that this Gravenhorst founded back in the 1880s. He was the founding president of St. Luke's Church. Dad was confirmed there on April 10th in 1938 at the age of 14. And he went through all the catechism. He professed and confirmed his faith in Jesus Christ. And he was given a memory verse. The memory verse is from Psalm 55. Cast thy burden on the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to fall. There's a setting by Felix Mendelssohn that I'd like to sing, that would have been familiar to almost every German at the time. And it's quite possible that Dad knew it too, but this is the scripture that Dad memorized. And to what degree he kept it in his heart as an encouragement, I cannot say, only God knows. But it's true for all of us. Even if we don't take it to heart, it's true nonetheless. If you want to chime in along as best you can, Claire and Lita are going to sing the melody. Elijah and I are going to fill in a little bit and try to make some music out of it. So anyway, it sounds like, cast thy burden upon the Lord. That's how it goes.
Cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He will never suffer the righteous to fall.
Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I shall in no wise cast out. He that raised up Jesus from the dead will also give life to our mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in us. Wherefore my heart is glad, and my spirit rejoiceth. My flesh also shall rest in hope. Thou shalt show me the path of life. In thy presence is the fullness of joy, and at thy right hand there is pleasure forevermore. Reading of John 6, verses 39 through 40. This is the Father's will, which hath sent me, that of all them which he hath given me, I should lose none, but should raise them up again, and at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up the last day. Amelia, the poem you're going to read is written by Edgar Guest, who is a British-born American poet. He wrote many poems that were inspiring to the armed services and the human services. That's what happened. We could just take a moment to reflect silently on our own thoughts and prayers. Our God, whose mercies cannot be numbered, accept these our prayers on behalf of the soul of thy servant departed, and grant him an entrance into the land of light and joy, in the fellowship of thy saints, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so in the sure and certain hope, for which we all hope, for the resurrection unto eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, commend to Almighty God the soul of our departed brother, Charles Kirchhoff Gravenhorst, and we commit his body to its resting place. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious unto him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace. Amen. Father, grandfather, companion in this life, Dad, we entrust you to God. Go forth from this world.
I seem to find the happiness I seek when we're out together dancing cheek to cheek. Heaven, I'm in heaven, and the cares that hung around me through the week seem to vanish like a gambler's lucky streak when we're out together dancing cheek to cheek. Oh, I love to climb a mountain and to reach the highest peak, but it doesn't